Good evening. The chief executive today urged the LegCo Finance Committee to pass her proposed $3.6 billion in new education funds before the summer recess. She also refused to expand the scope of a subsidy scheme for secondary school leavers enrolled in self-financed degree courses at tertiary education institutions. Has more.
LegCo's Finance Committee will be holding its last meeting tomorrow before the summer recess. The first item on tomorrow's agenda, an additional $3.6 billion funding request for the education sector. Part of the money is earmarked to fund a $30,000 annual subsidy for secondary school leavers who enroll in self-financing degree programs at certain tertiary education institutions. Before attending today's Executive Council meeting, Chief Executive Lam said whether the students will receive subsidies in the coming school year is up to the lawmakers. Some pan-democratic lawmakers have asked for the subsidy scheme to cover self-financed degree programs offered by the 8 government-funded universities as well. The CE refused their demand today.
This particular measure has the broad consensus and support of all the institutions, both the UGC institutions and the self-financing institutions. So I just find it not really very reasonable for individual members of the Legislative Council to sort of reverse that common consensus of the institutions.
Secretary for Education Kevin Yeung also spoke on the issue. He said the government has no backup plan in the event of the rejection of the funding request. Besides funding for education, public works are also on the line. The Finance Committee has yet to approve funding requests for 16 public works projects with a total cost of $76.4 billion. Projects include hospitals expansions and sewage projects. The Hong Kong Construction Association today urged lawmakers to pass the funding and not to use people's livelihood as bargaining chips. Caleb Leung, TVB News.
Chief Executive Carrie Lam has made it clear that she would not go the extra mile to pacify pro-democracy lawmakers after four of their colleagues were disqualified over their LegCo oaths.
The world will be different if you're willing to share. It's a beautiful thing to share life by giving blood. One nation can save three or more lives. Share life, give blood. You can do it.
Everyone can choose their pathway, straight or curved. There's no need to follow others. Make your own choice.
Vocational and professional education and training covers a wide range of occupations and includes relevant programs up to the level. It provides practical training to better prepare the younger generation for their future careers and helps them to enter profession. VPET, leading you to a professional pathway.
From the 1st of May 2017, the statutory minimum wage is raised to $34.50 per hour. Employees covered by the minimum wage ordinance are entitled to this rate regardless of mode of employment. Employees with disabilities can opt for assessment and receive wages according to the productivity assessed. For details, please call 277-1771 or visit the Labour Department website.
The vision of Hong Kong 2030 opportunities to win some of the seats. Carrie Lam was non-committal, citing ongoing appeals of the court cases. But Starry Lee, of the city's largest pro-government party, DAB, said holding the polls at the same time is the best use of resources. That, she insists, is nothing of political calculation. Adam Xu, TVB News.
A national monument was unveiled in the Netherlands in memory of the victims of Malaysia Airlines flight MH17 shot over Ukraine 3 years ago. Memorials were held in the Netherlands and Ukraine yesterday for the 298 people aboard the plane who lost their lives. Alan Bognier reports.
In memory of all victims of the MH17 plane crash.
The monument was unveiled near the Amsterdam airport where the flight originated. 196 people aboard the flight were Dutch citizens. Those killed in the crash came from 17 countries. King Willem-Alexander, Queen Maxima, and about 2,000 of the victims' relatives attended the ceremony. Flight MH17 was shot down over pro-Russian rebel-held territory in eastern Ukraine with a Russian-made Buk missile. International investigators concluded that the missile was fired from the rebel-held territory from a mobile launcher trucked in from Russia, which was then hastily returned there. Moscow, which denies involvement in the fighting in eastern Ukraine, also denies one of its missiles could have been used against Flight MH17. The Netherlands has called for suspects in the case to be tried in a Dutch court. Investigators say they've pinpointed about 100 people they want to speak to in connection with the investigation. Just days ago, Malaysia expressed hope that the identities of the suspects will be known by the end of the year. It's unclear whether Russia will cooperate if prosecutors request information or if the suspects are Russian. At the site of the crash in eastern Ukraine, local residents laid flowers at a memorial and held a small religious ceremony. Alan Bukniak, TVB News.
To a bizarre case in Minneapolis in the U.S. state of Minnesota, where police shot and killed an unarmed Australian woman in her pajamas. The grieving family fears they may never know what happened because officers had their body cameras turned off. Sonia Otero with the details.
4-year-old Justine Damon was shot to death Saturday night after she called the police for help on a possible sexual assault in the alley behind her home. Her fiancé and his son demand to know why those called to protect her killed her.
The death of Justine is a loss to everyone who knew her. It was Justine who called 911 on Saturday evening, reporting what she believed was an active sexual assault occurring. Sadly, her family and I have been provided with almost no additional information from law enforcement.
My mom is dead because the police officer shot her for reasons I don't know, and I demand answers.
Two officers responded to Damon's call for help. Dressed in her pajamas, she approached the police vehicle unarmed when, for reasons unknown, Officer Muhammad Noor opened fire and shot her more than once. The officer from Somalia has yet to explain why he shot her, and he and his partner say their body cameras were turned off. While most states equip police with automatic body cameras, Minneapolis officers have to manually turn theirs on. Critics say all signs point to police error. But with no video evidence, Damon's death may remain a mystery that the community called highly suspicious.
I have the same question everyone else has. Why weren't the body cameras activated?
Well, this is, in my mind, an execution. They had told her to leave her house. She went out to this area here, was talking to an officer in a police car, and the other officer shot her.
The mysterious shooting dominated news in Australia, where Damon was born and raised.
She was treasured and loved. We will really miss her.
Her father is demanding justice.
Justine was a beacon to all of us. We only ask that the light of justice shine down on the circumstances of her death.
Both officers have been placed on administrative leave pending the outcome of the investigation. Sonia Artero, TVB News.
A team of Afghan girls competed in an academic robotics competition in the United States after being twice denied entry into the country. They were finally allowed in, with U.S. President Donald Trump playing the unlikely hero. Jack Tang has the story.
Afghanistan isn't a country known for being on the cutting edge of robotics, nor is it known for being at the forefront of gender equality. But on this day, a group of Afghan teenage girls do their fatherland or any nation proud. They are among more than 150 teams representing their own country in the first global challenge. It's a robotics competition designed to encourage the young and eager to pursue careers in math and science in a world that is increasingly driven by technology. But it was a struggle for the Afghan girls to get there after Washington twice rejected their request for US visas without saying why. But as the saying goes, the third time's the charm. They finally arrived in Washington, D.C. over the weekend, but only had a fortnight to build and ship their ball-sorting robot, compared with 4 months for other teams. Despite all the hardships and setbacks, the team has kept its chin up and is just happy to be able to take part.
We are so happy we attended this competition. I can say our feeling to you now. With words we can say, describe our feeling.
Their change in fortune came courtesy of U.S. President Donald Trump, a man who has a less than pristine record when it comes to issues regarding Muslims and women. After all, he has been embroiled in controversy over his efforts to restrict immigration from several Muslim-majority nations, while some of his comments on women need not be repeated. Although Afghanistan is not on the list of restricted countries, Washington has often denied visa requests from Afghans over fears that they will refuse to return home. Jeff Tang, TVB News.
The observatory issued the amber rainstorm warning, which is... Apart from that, landslide and thunderstorm warnings are also in force. As Rachel Lang reports, heavy rain in the morning left many areas in the New Territories flooded.
The city was drenched again today. This time, Taipo, Sha Tin and Shai Kung were among the hardest hit areas. The area around Tin Kwok Road in Taipo was waterlogged. Did residents have a hard time going out, some even had trouble staying indoors. The water had this woman scrambling for sandbags to keep floodwaters out of her home, but it was a little too late. The water came quickly, giving us no time to close the door, she said. As a result, everything in the house was soaked in water. Drivers had to be extra cautious. Some parked vehicles were submerged in nearly 3 feet of water. This minibus was caught in the middle of the chaos. The fire services department dispatched officers to the flooded areas to help those trapped in the water. Floods also struck Sai Sha Road, linking Ma On Shan and Sai Kung, causing a halt to the traffic. Vehicles backed up on the road after it was reopened. The Hong Kong Observatory issued its first amber rainstorm warning today at around 8 a.m. The warning lasted 3 hours. Some parts of the New Territories received more than 100 millimeters of rain. But at 4:20 a.m., the amber rainstorm warning was in effect again. While more rain has been forecast, the weather is expected to improve gradually in the next few days. Rachel Lang, CBB News.
The long wait at emergency rooms at public hospital continues amid a surge in flu cases this summer. Over the past week, patients on average had to wait over 12 hours before seeing a doctor. More than 5,800 people sought help at emergency rooms on Monday. Even though that's 400 fewer than the day before, the overall occupancy rate at medical wards of public hospitals still exceed 114%. To address the shortage of beds and manpower, Chief Executive Carrie Lam suggested inviting employees from the Department of Health to help with general outpatient services at hospitals. Today, she pledged that her administration would fully support the hospital authority in providing those services. But some challenged that not all doctors are well-versed in carrying out frontline emergency room duties. And now, bookworms, get ready. The annual Hong Kong Book Fair opens tomorrow with a record-breaking 670 exhibitors.
A last-minute rush to get the books ready before the Hong Kong Book Fair opens tomorrow. Guidebooks will be hard to miss, with travel as this year's theme. However, expect to see titles on places beyond your average holiday hotspots. This exhibitor stocked up on books on Siberia and Iceland, places that may still be unfamiliar to local readers. He's hoping various promotions, including 70% discounts, can lure in more customers. But has the annual event become too commercial over the years and lost track to promote literature?
We are not promoting the travel books. Actually, we are promoting the travel novels.
Here's how. Besides bookstores, there are also exhibitions such as this one held with National Geographic. Visitors are encouraged to explore unique architecture and landscapes around the world through photos. There's also a zone featuring 9 writers, including explorer Rebecca Lee. During the week-long fair, more than 320 cultural events will take place.
some hosted by best-selling crime fiction novelist Sophie Hannah and travel author Sarah Wheeler.
If you want to visit the fair, adult tickets are $25 each, but here's a way to save a few bucks. Simply arrive at the venue before noon to get $10 tickets at the entrance.
Discounted tickets are also available to tourists upon presenting valid travel documents.
Sports now, and more gold for China at the Swimming World Championships in Budapest. As expected, Chinese athletes are dominating the diving competition. Xiting Mao and Chen Ai won the 3 meters synchron gold. Meanwhile, Yang Hao and Chen Ai Shen produced 10 perfect scores in the men's 10 meters platform synchro. Great Britain's Tom Daley and Daniel Goodfellow ended up in fourth.
Barry, 對皮膚唔好㗎，唔好食煙啦。
你病，我心痛㗎。
Let's give her our support. Let's encourage her to quit smoking.